Hello everyone, my name is Astrid and together with my colleague Michael, today I will tell you a little bit more about the Flemish Safe Online Initiative, Veilig Online in our own language, which is a training program for parents. So today we will give you a little bit of insight into our training program, the context, why we started it, some successes, challenges, and recommendation. And as already mentioned, we will also answer some of your questions. But first, I would like to know who you are. We have a poll ready to ask you who you are. We have quite a few options you can choose from. And if you belong to more than one category, I would like to ask you to choose the option from the perspective from which you are participating today. So for instance, if you are a teacher and a parent, but you are here mostly because you're a teacher, then maybe you can choose for the option teacher. Yes, I can see that the poll is launched now. So I will already continue, but I will see the results in a moment. So first of all, how did we all start? As already has been told, we started more than a decade ago in 2007. And Safe Online is the joint initiative of Gezinsbond, which is the Flemish Family Association, and Child Focus, which is the Belgian Better Internet Center. And in 2007, we started with five trainings for the whole year, so five gatherings with parents. But in the following years, the amount of trainings grew exponentially because parents do have quite a lot of questions about media education and how they can cope with the digital media that their children use in their own family. So in 2017, we renewed the whole training program so that it is more aimed to vulnerable parents. And this resulted in five different trainings. So we have five trainings about five different topics, which are social media, privacy, gaming, cyberbullying, and online relationships and sexuality. I also see the results are in. So I see that most of you are professionals. So I think this will be very interesting for you then, because we will not only focus on the content of our trainings, but also how we came to this training program. So if you would like to start something similar, this might be an interesting webinar for you. So as I was saying, this resulted into five different trainings. But why do we do this? And why do we organize trainings for parents? Well, that's because we noticed that parents do have quite a lot of questions about the digital media their children and teenagers use, and also how they can cope with this in their family. You can see here a quote, "I'm worried I won't have a clue how to guide my son through the technological maze." That's a concern that I think most parents share. And they also have questions on a wider range of topics, screen time, but also how they can monitor what their children are doing online, the age limit, how to deal with several children in their own home, gaming. In games, there's quite a lot of violence possible as well, online addiction, the law, etc., etc. These are all concerns parents can have, and we try to answer to these questions and concerns with our trainings. Parents are looking for how they can deal with this in their family, for educational models. But most of all, they want and they need to be reassured, because it's not because you have questions that you can't, that we can't answer to them. We really want to empower parents and reassure them, and show that that they can cope with this in their family. So we organize quite a few trainings each year. So we see quite a lot of parents, and we try to answer to these questions. And we also have some reactions from parents for you after a training as a starting point. And after this video, my colleague Michael will take over for a bit. So I'm hoping this will go well. Share. Okay.
Ik denk dat een van de belangrijkste zaken is dat je voldoende communiceert met kinderen.
Wat ik vandaag vooral heb geleerd is dat elk kind anders omgaat met social media en dat de aanpak ook heel verschillend kan zijn.
Door te communiceren leren kinderen ook van wat ze kunnen bekijken, wat ze niet kunnen bekijken.
Each year, our project grows exponentially.
Okay, so these were a few reactions from parents, and as you can see, we do like to emphasize communication. I will start sharing the presentation, and then Michael can take over.
So I'm going to tell about our vision and about our objectives, our project Safe Online. So we start from a positive vision of the use of online media by children and young people. But we also pay attention to the risks associated with use of online media. However, we mainly want to focus on the possibilities and the opportunities of gaming, social media, online sexuality, and the prevention of cyberbullying. And now more about our vision. What is our vision on parenting and online media? Well, the first one, children have the right to grow up and to develop themselves in a world where they can take full advantage of the opportunities and where they have the right online and offline to be protected. We want to stimulate the development of a critical mindset of youngsters. Our aim is to empower parents. We will focus on the strengths and what is going right. We believe in the strength and parenting competences of each adult. We support a positive dialogue, that's very important for us, and building trust, also important, between parents and their children. We envision parenting as a circular process, so a two-way process, in which mutual influence plays a key role. The behavior of parents always influences the child and vice versa. Parenting is a continuous learning process for each adult. We see the relationship between parents and children as equal, but parents choose their own parenting style. A positive approach based on dialogue and trust is fundamental. Parents should teach their children to protect themselves against online risks. We want to ensure that when there is a problem, a child can go talk with his parents. We want to show parents their responsibility and guide them. An open dialogue in an atmosphere of trust proves to be the best strategy for a safe and responsible use of social media by children and teenagers. We think it's important that parents have access to local parenting support within easy reach. And now our goals, of course, empowering parents. Parents know more about the media use of children and teenagers. And the second goal is that parents have insights into the importance of the online world. The third one, parents have a positive attitude towards their children and their digital world. And the goals in a longer term then? Parents talk more openly with their children about the internet. And parents apply parental tips from the trainings within their family. And then parents become stronger in the media education of their children. That's on the longer term. Is our training evidence-based? Yes, it is, because the development of our new training offer is with interactive online models are based on the input of vulnerable parents. So we organized 5 focus groups to find what questions the parents had and how they wanted to get an answer to it. They opted for realistic testimonials from children, young people, and parents. And they have an option to playful methods, just as a quiz. A working group was set up for each team to develop the module. These working groups were composed of trainers, experts from organizations, universities, and of course, employees of the Gezinsbond and Child Focus. And then the findings from research, just as the biennial Apenstaartjaren, that's Flemish, that's Dutch, it's a survey in a biennial survey in Flanders, in which children and young people are asked about their online behavior. After each training, the participants fill in an evaluation form. And those who fill in their email address on the evaluation form will receive an email 3 weeks after the training. And so they got a link to an online form to check the impact of the training session. Then how we do reach parents? First of all, we want to reach schools and parent associations, and we regularly send newsletters to the schools to organize a training evening for parents. They can organize training at a reduced rate. And then, of course, local branches of our own association, the Gezinsbond, can also organize a training. We believe it is important that vulnerable parents receive training. We therefore sent a newsletter to more than 700 organizations that work with parents in vulnerable situations. A training session is free for them. These parents were also involved in the recreation of the modules and give testimoniums themselves. So we give an example. During a focus group in a center for families in poverty, we noticed a mother with 7 children about how she made rules and agreements in the family. We made an appointment with her in the center, and her oldest son was also wanted to come along. We asked them a few questions independently and mixed the answers into a video clip that is now part of our module of social media. Let's have a look to the result. I know Astrid must switch a little bit.
Ik gebruik mijn gezin voor Facebook, Instagram, Snapchat en voor andere dingen zoals Google, meest YouTube.
Voordien was er eigenlijk niet veel afspraken, waaraan ik merkte dat mijn kinderen heel veel op de iPad en de gsm zaten. Dus het gezinscontact was ook wel weg. Dan ben ik aan tafel gaan zitten met mijn man en mijn kinderen en wij zo tot afspraken gekomen.
Als het eigenlijk school is, is het maximaal wel een uurtje. En dat is het eigenlijk, zoals nu de grote vakantie of zaterdag of zondag of zo'n week, dan zit ik er eigenlijk lang op.
Ja, af en toe willen ze zoiets een kwartiertje langer. Maar ja, van een kwartier komt een half uur en van een half uur komt een uur. Dus nee, afspraak is afspraak.
Ja, aan tafel of zo. Dat doen we echt niet. Maar als dat slapen is of zo, durf ik die wel eens mee te nemen.
Tommy, ja, durft soms regels overschrijven. Durft af en toe zijn gsm mee naar zijn slaapkamer pakken. Maar dan ontdekken wij dat. Maar normaal, als hij gaat slapen, laat hij zijn gsm op. En af en toe ga ik zoiets naar de keuken voor drinken te pakken. En dan zie ik zijn gsm nu liggen en dan weet ik dat. Hij heeft dat nog maar een paar keer geprobeerd.
Nou, dan krijgen we niet echt een straf, maar dan zeggen ze tegen ons, ja, je mag dat niet meer doen. Dat is eigenlijk onze gsm afgepakt. Dat we eigenlijk leren. Van onze gsm eigenlijk niet meer naar boven te pakken.
Als ze de regels overschrijden, wordt een dag erop. Beginnen met een kwartier afgepakt van uw gsm. Mogen ze nog maar 3 kwartier op uw gsm in plaats van een uur.
Ik vind van de afspraken dat dat heel goed is. Nou, zoals aan tafel, geen gsm. En s'avonds eigenlijk naar uw kamer. Vind ik dat wel goed. Maar het leukste zou zijn dat ik mijn gsm aan tafel zou nemen, maar ik maak die regels niet, mijn ouders wel, dus.
Bij mij thuis de strengste, ze zeggen meestal de mama.
I hope you can hear me now.
We can hear and see you. Perfect.
Yes. Okay. So I will continue with telling you a little bit more about the actual training program and the online modules we use. As already mentioned, we have 5 different online modules, and in a moment we'll take a look at one of these modules, the social media module. So for each topic, there is a different online training module, and each training module consists of a lot of visual attractive material, and also we integrated quite a few methodologies into these training modules. These online modules are used during our trainings, so the trainer uses these as a guideline throughout the whole training session. But they are also available on our website so that parents can also take a look at the online modules themselves. As Michael already mentioned, these online modules were developed together with vulnerable parents. And they have 2 main focuses. So in the first part of the module, we focus on what children and young people do online. For instance, for social media, which social media apps do they use? Or for gaming, which games do they play? Why do they like them so much? So that's the first focus of the online modules. And the second focus is on what you can do as a parent. So in that part, we focus on how you can cope with all of these different digital media that your children use in your own family. Each training module has quite a few methodologies integrated. For instance, we use a quiz to show parents a few digital media that children can use. We also have a lot of testimonials from children, from teenagers, from parents, and from experts. And all these testimonials are non-scripted videos. So we asked the participants or the children and the parents a question and about a certain topic. For instance, sharenting. We will see this video a bit later in the presentation. And we just ask their opinion, their experiences. And these are the spontaneous reactions that these children and parents have on this topic. We also have propositions with a concrete opinion in every training module. And we always end every training session with the 10 parenting tips. So these are very concrete tips that parents can apply in their own home. Now, all these different methodologies are developed to stimulate the interaction between parents, because we do find it very important that it's not only the trainer speaking during a training session, but that parents can also share their own experiences, how they cope with these digital media in their own family. Maybe they have tips for other parents. And we noticed that this is a way of working that really works very well. And parents do learn quite a lot from each other this way. And also because we have quite a few methodologies inside this training module, this allows a trainer to start from the questions that parents have. For instance, if parents want to start by seeing some videos of the children, that is possible. But if they want to start with the social media quiz as a warm-up, that's also possible. So the trainer has to be quite flexible, but this allows for the trainer to really make sure that the training is adapted at the questions that all the parents in the audience might have. So no training is the same, but we do have some content that should be integrated in every training session. So as you can see here, this is a screenshot of the social media module. And if all goes well, I will now guide you through the first part of our social media module. Just so you know, normally all of our online modules are in Dutch, our own language, but we did translate one of the training modules into English. So this training module is in English and the videos are subtitled in English. As you can see, this is our, are you seeing the online module? I'm not seeing any one of you.
Yes, we can see it perfectly.
Okay, very well. So this is our training module. As you can see, there are 7 different parts. So 3 on this side, 3 on the other side. And then at the end, there are the parenting tips. Let's take a look at the first one. This is the social media quiz. So everything in this module is really aimed at the topic of social media. So as you can see here, we have a few logos of different social media apps. Some of you may know all of them. Some of you may have quite a few apps that you don't know already. And behind every logo, there is a question targeted at this specific app. I will launch the second social media app. And as you can see, there are 3 answering options. And the question is, how long does your photo sent via Snapchat, because this is the logo of Snapchat, remain online? And if all goes well, there will also be a poll right now so that you can answer yourself. So what do you think is the right answer? If you send a photo via Snapchat, how long will this photo remain online? Is this 1 to 10 seconds? Can you choose this yourself? Or will the photo remain online forever? I will wait a little bit now because I do want to see what most of you answer, and then we can see what happens if we click one of the answers. This way you can experience it a little bit, how this would go in an actual training session. And for those of you who do not know Snapchat, it's a very popular app in Belgium. You can make photos or videos. And it also became very popular because you can use quite a lot of different filters. And these filters are now also integrated in quite a lot of other social media apps. And it is very popular among young people because they can send photos and videos to their friends. So I can see that most of you answered 1 to 10 seconds, or you can choose this yourself. So it's the same amount of answers for those 2 options. So I will go for the second one. and you will see why. Because this is the right answer. And here you can see a short description of the Snapchat app. And we also include for every app a screenshot of what the app looks like. So for all of these different social media, we have a question and then three answering options. And behind every, for every app, there is also this description of the app and then the screenshot. I would like to try a second one with you, a second social media app. This one, I'm not going to tell you what this is. And the question for this app is, do you recognize this app? Do you know what kind of an app this is? The options are, it's a streaming site, it's a microblog, or it's a message app. So I'm very curious for this one because in our experience, this app is not that well known among parents. But it is well known among most of the children and teenagers in Belgium. So I'm very curious to see what your answers will be. And this way of working, actually, this quiz, we integrated this because we do think that this can be a really interesting starting point for parents. And this can also already stimulate the discussion and the interaction between parents, because a trainer can choose to explain the app via the text that is integrated into the module. But a trainer can also ask the parents if they know the app or if someone in the audience can explain to the other parents what this app is. So we do find this quiz a very thankful methodology to use during the training session. So I also have the results of the poll, and most of you have chosen for option three. It's a message app. Now we will see if this is correct. Unfortunately, this is not correct. The logo is of Twitch. Twitch is a website. It's actually a streaming website for gamers. So you can go to this website to view, as you can see on the screenshot here, these are different streams of different games. As you can see, this is a stream that has 3,000 people watching the stream live. But there are also streams of less popular or more popular players. And as a gamer, you can also choose to stream your own gaming in real life. So it's really a gaming platform and a streaming website. So this was a little example of how our social media quiz works. And this really is a very nice way to stimulate the interaction between parents. Now, the second part of our social media module is what children say. These are all testimonials of children regarding different topics. And these children are all between 8 and 12 years old. And they give their experiences or reactions on, for instance, what is TikTok? Control from your parents. Why are social media fun? So these are all short videos, maximum of 2 minutes. And behind or after every video, there also is a concrete parenting tip regarding this topic. So for instance, for this video, a parenting tip regarding TikTok will be included. The third part of our module is what teenagers say. So these are also testimonials, but from teenagers between ages 12 and 18. And they also give share their experiences and opinions or on, for instance, in this video, teenagers talking about how many friends they have online, how much time do they think they spend online. This one is about social media in general. Here we have a reaction of a teenager or a young person that is also a YouTuber. So these two parts of the module really are about showing what children and young people do online. Why do they like it so much? What do they do? And we do notice that these two parts of the module are also very interesting to stimulate this interaction between parents. Now, we also have a few other parts in this module, and my colleague Michael will guide you through them.
Yes. On the right side of the module, that is what parents can do. And in the first section of what parents can do, we have three testimonials from parents. And you know that guy, you saw the video yet, it's about rules and agreements in a family. The second one is a father who speaks about the agreements and the trust in older teens' use of social media. And the third one is a mother that talks about her adolescent daughter's use of social media under the motto, trust and letting go. So the first is rules and agreements, the second is agreements and trust, and the third one is trust and letting go by the children getting older. Then the following part, these are five propositions to discuss. Behind every proposition, every statement, there is a certain vision. So we're going to see in the middle, you see under 13, no Facebook. And how we do it in a training session? Well, the proposition let parents think about their own opinion about the subject. They also listen to other parents' opinions, and so they can possibly adjust theirs. The participants have to choose between agree, or rather agree, and on the other side, not agree, disagree, or rather disagree. There are no right or wrong answers. People who agree and people who disagree can then talk in turn. And then there is time for discussion, 5 or 10 minutes. At the end of the discussion, the trainer can tell the vision behind the proposition without or with letting see the visual. And now you can see the visual that's behind the proposition of Facebook. So, and you can see it. That is our vision behind it. But first of all, it's important that parents think themselves about it. And then in the next part of our module, you can see three experts, and they talking about the first one, screen time. And that's very important for parents with young children. It's a hot issue for them. The second is why YouTube is so popular. And the third one is what you can do if sexting goes wrong. And that's an employee of Child Focus who tells about it. After watching the video, you can ask what most important to the participant in the video was. And that, then you can ask also how they gonna use it in the education of the children. And the last section of the module, these are the tips. A training always ends with the 10 most important tips for parents about the use of social media by children and young people. The trainer goes through the 10 tips briefly, indicates where they were discussed in the training session, and explain the tips that were not or hardly discussed. So you see here, tip one, we're gonna see another, tip two. And so in every model, there are 10 tips. But let's see how young people themselves want to be educated. And therefore, we have a video where young people say, I want that and be educated by my parents by this way. Let's have a look. The video is disappeared.
All okay.
I'm having some technical issues.
With the...
my second screen has disappeared.
Okay.
I'm just going to...
Otherwise, Isabel, do you have the second one?
So...
Ah, is it back?
I've disconnected it. I'm hoping this will work.
Okay, let's give it a try.
Geef jullie kind de vrijheid om te doen wat ze willen, maar houd nog een beetje in de gaten. Geef ze wel de privacy. Bijvoorbeeld, ja, ik wil ook niet dat mijn mama al de snapshots ziet die ik binnenkrijg. Maar ze mag er wel op gaan, dus voor mijn part stoort me dat niet. En ze mag mijn stories bekijken en zo. Maar ze geeft mij de vrijheid om te doen, te communiceren met wie ik wil. En ik kom niet altijd over mijn schouders om meekijken. Dus geef jullie kind de vrijheid, maar... houd nog steeds in de gaten, zou ik zo zeggen.
Laat je kind niet te vaak op de gsm gaan, want dat is echt verslavend. Want ik ben er echt de hele tijd op en dat is niet goed. Want ik weet van mezelf dat ik echt soms gewoon mijn gsm ver weg moet leggen en zo. Omdat ik anders, want dat leidt keihard af als je bijvoorbeeld studeert en zo. Dus laat hun een uurtje per dag of zo weg van hun telefoon. Dan kunnen ze echt nuttigere dingen doen dan dat.
Laat ons doen, we weten wat te doen en ja, als het misschien te ver gaat, kunnen ouders ingrijpen, maar ze moeten ons een beetje meer rust laten eigenlijk. Voilà, dat zou ik gewoon zeggen.
Geef je kind zoveel mogelijk vrijheid, maar zorg ook dat je goed in contact staat met je kind, zodanig dat ze je veel kunnen toevertrouwen, dat je kind niet alles moet verbergen voor je, want dat is wel jammer.
Niet te veel probeer te controleren wat je kind doet. Dus geef ze een beetje vrijheid, maar dat betekent niet dat je gewoon het helemaal compleet moet negeren.
I'm going to continue the PowerPoint presentation. Okay. So I'm looking at the time and I see we don't have that much time left.
Don't worry, we're fine on time. Take your time.
Okay. We do have quite some other topics as well. So we gave you a little insight into our social media module. But I would also like to emphasize a few other topics. We have chosen for three topics. Gaming, something regarding internet and privacy, and cyberbullying. So to start with, let's take a look at gaming. Most of the children really like to game, but most of the parents don't understand why their children love it so much. And what is important to know is that gaming has become a form of entertainment, such as, even more so, a hobby, just as much as reading or playing music, or another hobby app. And gaming also has quite a social aspect. Most children or teenagers really like to game together with their friends or maybe meet other friends through this gaming app. Gaming also has some positive aspects, and the children can learn specific skills. For instance, playing together as a team, or learning English, because most of the games are played internationally, and English is the common language. But parents also need to know that gaming has become a multi-million-dollar business. And gaming is not just about playing the game itself anymore. It's about the whole experience of playing with other people, the merchandising around it, events regarding gaming have also become very important. And gaming has really created a whole new community of people playing games. People, not only children, also adults playing games. So when talking to parents, it is important to keep all of this in mind and to emphasize all of these elements as well, because if they see their child gaming, they just don't think about all of these aspects around it. And a question that quite a lot of parents have is, how long is too long? If my child is gaming, when do I have to become worried? Well, this depends on quite a few different aspects, for instance, on the age of the child, but also is there homework that needs to be done? Are there other hobbies that my child is still playing, but also on the game itself? And we find it really important to involve the child itself in the rules and agreements that are made in a family. And there is a difference between rules and agreements also. A rule is something that you impose as a parent to your child, and this can work well for really young children, but the older your child becomes, the more important it is to have agreements that are made between the child and the parent. And for instance, you can do this in your family by asking your child, what would you think is a decent amount of time to spend on gaming? And then you can check in with yourself as a parent, how long do I think is okay? Can we find a middle ground in between this? And can we make an agreement on this? And what is also important when making agreements is how you will act as a parent if the agreement is not followed. And that's also something very important to incorporate in this agreement. And as with every other aspect in life, balance is everything when gaming. For instance, if a teenager is gaming 3 hours a day on a holiday, that's a completely different situation than a child that is gaming maybe the exact same amount of time, but has lost its appetite, is not engaging in social activities anymore, is not making its homework. That's a completely different situation. So the balance with the whole aspect of your life around gaming is also very important. We also have a video of young children sharing what their parents know about them spending time gaming. So I will also share this video.
Maar ze weten ook wat dat ik speel met mama.
Maar ze weten ook wat dat ik speel. Mijn mama kijkt soms mee. Mijn papa kijkt dan eens welke spelletjes ik al allemaal heb. En dan zeggen ze bijvoorbeeld, start dat keer op en dan kijken ze en controleren ze dat en dan al mijn spelletjes. En ze vinden het allemaal oké.
Die kennen Battlelands, die kennen Brawl Stars. Ze spelen dat natuurlijk niet. Ik denk dat ze daar iets te oud voor zijn. Maar ze kennen dat. Dus ze weten wat ik doe.
Soms begrijpen ze het wel. Soms speelt mijn papa dat ook eens. Niet zo heel vaak, maar soms speelt hij wel eens met mij. En ik heb het ook eens met mijn mama gedaan. Op de iPad was hij dan en ik op de PlayStation. En ze vond het wel een beetje grappig, zo samen. En ze snapte het natuurlijk niet zo goed. Mijn papa snapt het wel, maar hij kan het nog niet zo super goed. Maar hij vindt het wel tof om te doen.
Okay, I'm back. So as you can see, there is quite a big difference between how parents show involvement in the gaming of their children. And that's something we do find very important as a parent, to show interest in what your child is doing online. Is it gaming or engaging in other social media apps? It's important to have an open communication between parent and child. Now, another topic that we discussed during our trainings, specifically during the privacy training, is sharenting. For those of you who do not know this word, sharenting is a compilation of the words sharing and parenting. And nowadays, we as adults, but also parents, share a lot of our daily life online. And this is quite okay, I think. The online world has become part of our world nowadays. But it is important when sharing pictures of children to keep a few things in mind. So the laws about sharing pictures of underage children are different in countries, but every child does have their own privacy rights. And it is very important when talking to parents to raise awareness around this topic of parents sharing images of their children online. And totally forbidding parents sharing pictures of their children will have no effect, but we would like to empower parents on thinking critically before posting something online. You can let parents reflect on this topic so that they will think before they post a picture online. For instance, they can ask themselves, is this picture okay for the whole world to see? Because there is quite a big difference in sharing something online, for instance, on Facebook or on Instagram, where everyone can see this, or in a private WhatsApp group. That's quite a big difference. You can also ask yourself as a parent, will my child become embarrassed when he or she sees a picture when they are older? But also, what does my partner think about this? Can we make some agreements on this? So we do find this that this is a very important topic to discuss with parents so that they raise awareness around this and also start thinking critically before posting something. And you might think that young children are not very aware of this topic, but that's not true. Even young children have an opinion on this. And we also have a short video of children between ages 8 and 12 sharing their own experiences with their parents sharing photos. Sorry. So share.
Dan vind ik dat niet zo tof dat ze mijn foto's daarop plakken, alleen als ik het wel goed vind, want ze kunnen daar alles mee doen en wij weten niet wat daar dan mee gebeurt.
Ik vind het altijd leuk. Mij maakt het eigenlijk op zich niet zoveel uit. Ze maken foto's en ik zeg altijd plaats dat op alles wat je hebt, want ik vind dat gewoon leuk.
Nee, mijn mama zet het daar gewoon op zonder dat ik het weet.
Soms maken ze foto's als ik in mijn pyjama zit en dat vind ik dan niet leuk.
Ja, van mij zetten ze daar soms ook dingen op. Zoals bijvoorbeeld naar een pretpark gaan of zo. Of als we naar de bossen een keer gaan, zetten ze ook wel soms dingen van mij erop. Ze vragen het wel altijd, als dat mag. Als, het niet, zo, als ik er bijvoorbeeld niet lelijk op sta of zo, dan zeg ik wel van nee, liever niet. Maar ze vragen het wel altijd.
So as you can see, even these young children have quite different opinions on this topic of sharing thing. And it's important as a parent to really reflect on what your child would like. So we also have quite a few parenting tips about sharing thing. The first one is to think about posting photos of younger children and to also be careful with suggestive images. For instance, children being naked online, that's something that you do have to be very careful with. The second one is also to ask permission from your child before posting a picture online. As you saw, these children ages between 8 and 12 already had quite strong opinions on their parents sharing their images online. So even with young children, you can start asking if it's okay to post a picture on Facebook or to send it to grandma via WhatsApp or something like that. So it is important to really take this opinion of your child into mind. And also when your child becomes older, You can also take a look at these older pictures that are already online. And if there are pictures that they don't want to be online anymore, you can take them offline. I think it's very important to do this together with your children. So because it's a picture of their own, so they can have quite strong opinions on that. Okay, now this is also a video.
And for the last team, we will present start with the video. So the only words we saw in the video was bullying, talk about it. These were the only words in the video, but did you see the impact of cyberbullying? And you know, cyberbullying is online bullying. And it's a lot of things than offline bullying, because cyberbullying can happen all the time. 24 hours on 24 hours. And it is also invisible. It is anonymously. We have three roles in cyberbullying. You have the victim that undergoes the cyberbullying. You have the bully, that's of course the offender. And you have the bystander, or the witnesses. And we think that an intervention by the bystanders, by the witnesses, is very important to stop cyberbullying. Cyberbullying needs an integrated approach from school, teachers, parents, and so on. First and foremost, bullying is unacceptable. And that's the other dia. Assume that bullying usually doesn't stop by itself. What can you, as a parent, do if your child is bullied? So be attentive to signals from your child that indicate bullying behavior, such as sudden loss of weight or appetite, stress, mood swings, no longer likes to go to school, or conclude social media. Listen to your child to express his or her feelings. And let your child give themselves ideas to react. Help your child to think of assertive reactions and look for help, of course, at the school. Talk to teachers and school management about the bullying and try to find a solution together. So these were three teams after you saw the team of social media. Now we're going to say a few things about the outcomes. In pre-COVID time, we have 200 trainings each year where we can reach 2,500 parents. The evaluation of the webinars and the evaluation is about the expectation of the participants, the approach, the moderator's contribution, and so on. And it was scored good to very good. But what is the impact of a training session 3 weeks after the training? Over 80% of the participants communicate better with their children after the training, and over 80% is more positive about digital media. Over 50% of the participants, they are doing something about the parental tips at home. And also over 50% consulted the modules on the website online. So, what are the most important things of the successes of the project? Well, first of all, it's the partnership between two big organizations in Flanders, that's Gezinsbond and Child Focus. And it's very important to keep the modules up to date. So each year we have new testimonials, new content for the modules. And it's also important to consult with the target audience, such as vulnerable parents. And we have a group of dedicated trainers, and we give trainers and coaching. We coach our trainers so they stay up to date. Very important is the interactivity of our training sessions. And of course, you know yet the positive vision in it. Then the following dia, yes. The challenges is of course to reach parents in vulnerable situations. Pre-COVID, 20% of the trainings were in groups of vulnerable parents. And now, after the lockdowns, it's very important to have more of them. But by COVID-19, there were in 2020 only 50 trainings. So we also made 7 free webinars of our training sessions, and we reached more than 4,000 parents with these 7 webinars. And you can see them now on the YouTube channel of the Gezinsbond for free. In this year, we started with online training sessions, so interactive online training sessions in a small group, like the training sessions on locations, and we do that until the training sessions on location can start again. And we also working on a 6th module for parents, and it's a module for parents with children between 0 and 7 years old. And on the following dia, yes, we have also an European Safe Online Initiative, an Erasmus Plus project that started in 2020 and is based on our Flemish Safe Online Initiative. So it's we are the example that other countries can make their own modules and trainings. So like in Greece, Cyprus, Romania, Bulgaria, the French-speaking part of Belgium. And the project is from 2020 to 2023. And now we have yet made a document with the content and with the methodologies and how it you must start and grow up the project. And now we give coaching sessions to the master trainers of each module. So this year they're going to make their own modules. And then the following dia. Our recommendations is to involve parents in the creations of a training and also vulnerable parents. Which questions do they have? And how they want to have an answer. Start with a positive vision on online media and work with organizations that have expertise. Make the offer widely known via schools and other organizations, and make sure the offer remains affordable. And so we are on the Q&A, have you questions for us?
Thank you both.